us with your presence in this place, O Lord. And place the power of your Spirit within us, with the hearts of worship to celebrate your goodness. With voices of thanksgiving, we sing of your righteousness. By your grace, we have been saved. By your hand of blessing, our hearts are made glad. Be one with us, O Lord. Grace us with your presence.
Need to be made. I would like to introduce you to a friend of mine and Sue's. This is Leonard and Shirley Smith, and they're doing some church shopping, so we convinced them that we are the best around, so they're visiting today. Great job.
Well, do you ever hear us at church talk about Jesus and his disciples? Yeah? Well, his disciples, yes, he talked to them and he said, come and follow me. But they were his friends. They were the closest people to him. When he was doing his ministry, when he was teaching people and loving on him, his disciples helped him. They supported him, they took care of him, and he taught them. They all taught each other, just like our friends do for us. So sometimes, when maybe things at church or things don't always make sense, or God seems really far away, I want you to think of him as a friend, just like the disciples did. Even if he's not sitting beside you, like Gary is, you can always talk to him. Okay? Got it? And we're going to start right now by doing a prayer, okay? Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for the friends in our lives who teach us so much and help us along the journey. And we thank you that you are our friend too. Teach us and open our hearts and help us to know that you are always with us. Amen.
Share our joys and our concerns. Do we have a I understand that there was an unfortunate incident in LA last night, and might please be praying for all the victims of that this time. Violence is totally unnecessary and horrific. We for it and we pray for the survivors, the victim, for everyone involved.
I don't think your microphone is.
My mic is not on. That would help. Can you all hear me now? Let's repeat that. I was asking, started off by saying, good morning. My name is Henry. This is my time for our boys and our concerns. You all look lovely this morning. And that is all I said, just kidding. No, but in all seriousness, there was an attack last night in Los Angeles at a nightclub overnight. We would pray for all victims and for everyone involved and survivors. Yes, Pam.
Our Sarah is having her knee replacement finally. Our Sarah's having her knee replacement finally this week. So I think it's Wednesday.
That's awesome. That's fine. Yes, beautiful. Great success on that. Yes, Sue.
And let's ask prayers for Dan and his family again. We got a phone call this morning that his aunt passed away at 6:30 this morning.
Prayers seem unending, our needs unending, and yet we know that in you we can find that strength, find that resource, find that shoulder to lean on, to be a source of life and love forever. Pray this morning that our strength might be fulfilled and renewed, and that those that we love might know you, and those that we don't know might know you, and everyone might know you and the love that you have. Pray this in the prayer that your Son Jesus taught us to pray.
Our second second scripture this morning comes from 1 Corinthians, chapter 1, verses 10 to 18. Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you be in agreement, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be knit together in the same mind and the same purpose. For it has been made clear to me by Chloe's people that there are quarrels among you, my brothers and sisters. What I mean is that each of you says, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Has Christ been divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one can say that you were baptized in my name. I did baptize also the house of Stephanas. Beyond that, I do not know whether I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel, and not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross of Christ might not be empty of its power. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So, Mom, Morgan says I should shop at Hollister, Nike, and American Eagle. High-rise jeans are weird, and I need to try CoverGirl mascara, like yesterday. I'm way behind. Oh, and in gym class, she told me that the deodorant I use is for old ladies, and I need to switch to Dove. Oh, and I need to buy a curling iron. Can we go shopping? Although, I don't know if I really want to do that, because then Chelsea said that Morgan doesn't know what she's talking about, and that Old Navy has better jeans, and that I need a cheese straightener. Because guys think straight hair is prettier. Oh, and she said Maybelline is better than CoverGirl. What's a cheese, my mom said. It's a hair straightener, Mom. Keep up here. I roll my eyes as only a 13-year-old girl can. So now, Morgan and Chelsea aren't talking to each other, and I'm stuck in the middle. So Mom, my plan is this. I'm going to get some clothes from Hollister, Nike, American Eagle, and Old Navy. And then I can get CoverGirl and Maybelline makeup and rotate days wearing them, so then they'll both be happy. And then on Mondays and Wednesdays and Fridays, I'll curl my hair, and on Tuesdays and Thursdays, I'll straighten it. Then everyone wins, and I get to keep both of my friends. I'm literally a genius, Mom. How soon can we go shopping? Anna, why do you want all of this stuff? You have plenty of clothes and hair tools. Why do you want this? Mom, I already told you. Did you hear what Morgan and Chelsea said? I need this stuff. Honey, why did you become friends with Morgan and Chelsea? Did you become friends with them because of their clothing and makeup? Well, no. We started talking and playing together in elementary school. And they were nice to me, I said. That's right. They liked you for who you are. That's not going to change now. You don't need to live your life trying to be popular. Fighting about makeup and clothing is silly. Your friendship isn't about that. It's about what's in here. We're not going to buy you all new things. Go to school and wear the things you like. And be kind to Morgan and Chelsea. And remember the reason you became friends with them in the first place. My mom shared. At age 13, every quarrel or argument with friends felt like a major life-threatening ordeal. None of them actually ever were, but they felt that way. Each time these arguments and disagreements would happen, my mom would have to bring me back to reality She reminded me of what really matters. Our friendship, where we started, and treating one another well. Well, I'm not 13 anymore, and hopefully I'm not as dramatic, but I still need those reminders quite often. I often have to ask myself, who do I follow? Why am I doing this? Where did this come from? What's this all about? In the long run, does this disagreement matter? Is it significant enough to hurt my relationship with someone? The older I get, the more I realize that I'm not alone in these thoughts. As people, we disagree, we argue, split up, and separate. We all do this. It seems like it's in our nature. And the church is no exception to this. It happens now, and it happened in the early church. I'm sure you have your own examples, both big and small. We know churches can disagree over buildings, budgets, theological differences, church leaders, and many, many other things. As long as there are people in the church, there will be varying opinions, and that's okay. Yet sometimes, before an argument or disagreement starts, we simply need to remember whose we are. Paul reminds the church in Corinth of this when they're caught up in which preacher to follow. It's tearing them apart. They're saying things like, well, I follow Paul, or I follow Apollos, or I follow Cephas, as a way to boast and argue about which leader is better. And Paul has to shift their thinking. Paul has to bring them back to where they started. Paul pushes them to look past the preacher and to look at the message. He says, has Christ been divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? The answer to these questions is no. Christ was not divided. They were not baptized in the name of Paul, Apollos, or Cephas. They were baptized in the name of Jesus. Jesus was the one who was crucified to give new life to everyone. Jesus was the one who said, come follow me, and I will send you out to fish for people. All that we do as people in the church should lead to that. It should lead people not to praise us or to follow us, but to Christ. Paul isn't chastising the Corinthians. He's leading them back to where they started. Back at Christ. He's asking them, who do you truly follow? Who saved you? And how do we get back to focusing on him? Because if we keep letting all this other stuff, these divisions and disagreements, get in the way, then this is all foolishness and empty words. Christ is what matters. Following him, living and acting in a way that shines the love of Jesus to all those around us. Just as my mom told me as a 13-year-old, to remember how my friendship started with Morgan and Chelsea, Paul is telling the church in Corinth not to get so caught up in everything else that we lose sight of our vision and our core, to share the love and good news of Jesus Christ. I pray that each of us can take this reminder to heart for now and in the future. As a church. You see, I love when I hear disciples say, we have no creed but Christ. That is so true. But then I wonder, how do we live that out as a church? How do we follow Paul's instructions in verse 10 that for all of us to be in agreement, that there will be no divisions among you, but that you will be knit together in the same mind and same purpose. That is a big, big task. Be in agreement, have no divisions, be knit together, same mind, same purpose. It almost seems impossible on some days. But I think it's a journey to get there. And we have to start somewhere. So let's go back to where it all began. Let's go back to Christ. If we follow Jesus, let's see the steps that he took. Let's see how he acted, and then let's do that. We know that he listened. So when we come to a disagreement or a hard time in church, let's take time to listen to each other. To listen to each other's opinions. And not listening to respond, but listening to understand. What is the saying? You have two ears and one mouth for a reason. I think we can all work on that. Because sometimes when we're talking, someone says something and something sparks in our mind. And we're just thinking about what we can say or how they can respond. And we don't actually listen to what they're sharing. Let's see if we can find out where people are coming from to gain a bigger picture their ideas and understanding. Because when we take time to put ourselves in someone else's shoes, it's hard to be upset or angry when you get to know someone. And when we put ourselves in someone else's shoes, it expands our compassion and grace for each other. And that's what Christ did. So he listened, he loved. Sometimes we don't feel like we're going to be able to compromise or come to an agreement. Yet we must remember that the person we disagree with most is a beloved child of God, just like we are. Christ connected us in his love as the body of Christ. And if we belong together to Christ, then we belong to each other. This is a circle of care, a body that supports one another, that holds hope for each other. And sometimes in that, we compromise. We put our own opinions aside for one another. If one part of the body suffers, we all suffer. And if one celebrates, we all celebrate. Friends, we have to remember where we started. There's a few questions I want you to think about today. What made you want to follow Christ? What made you want to be a part of Central Christian? What keeps you coming back? What helps you keep your faith? Think of those answers. Brainstorm on them. And once you have them, hold those in your heart. Don't let them go. And I want you to remember those things, especially when life gets hard, when people drive you crazy, or it seems like things are a mess, and you can't find any goodness around you. Remember Jesus. Remember where you began. Remember his love and grace. Remember the people around you who have carried you. Remember who you follow. And keep going. Because Christ promises to be with us along the journey. Amen.
hide it under a bushel. No, I'm gonna let it shine. This church does not hide what it has. It does not stay in one place, captive, sitting on its flame like a dragon sitting on a hoard of gold. It shares what it has abundantly with the community around it, openly welcoming and sharing all that it has. Because that's who we are. That's who we are. Who do we follow today, tomorrow, next week, next year? Where do we go from here? That, my friends, is up to you. It's up to you. Please, give as you are able so that all might benefit. Thank you.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, we praise and thank you for the opportunity to gather in your house of worship and your invitation to partake of your Holy Supper. May the bread and cup impress upon our hearts to start each day with God, be determined to follow his lead, and continue walking with him even when things aren't going our way. By listening to him, we will know what to do. By trusting him, we know it's going to work out okay. And by obeying him, we will be blessed with joy and peace. In Christ's name, we ask this. Amen.
You are invited to join Central Christian Church. You can join by transfer of membership, by confession of faith, or by the renewal of the vows of your baptism. Or you can come up during the singing of our next anthem and give a hug, a hello. Come and say hi for a moment, because here we're waiting for you, ready for you. Our doors are open wide. Let's all stand and sing together our hymn of invitation. Worship is done.
And before we get started, I would recommend that you pull out your hymnals for this one. The words will be on the screen, but there's quite a little bit that goes on in there. It is number 539, and we will be doing all three verses. It might seem like a lot, but that's why the Hallelujah Choir is going to help out from up here. And so just follow along, have some fun. You might be singing this for the rest of the day. So.
Oh,
Go forth with the grace of God, and may the God of grace go with you. Amen.